to Selena in Nashville, Tennessee on EWTN app. Hello, Selena.
Hi, thank you for taking my call. I have a question about Pope Julius. My younger sister is taking a college history course where they taught her that Pope Julius cut backroom deals to get to the papacy and that he sold indulgences for the new Vatican. And they told her that that's why Luther left the church, because it was corrupt.
Yeah, but it was at a discount.
Now my sister is saying that she would have done the same and that she would have left the church too. Okay. And that's why she doesn't agree fully with the church teachings. So I just don't know how to respond to that.
Well, I'm not sure which Pope Julius she's talking about. I would assume it's Pope Julius II. But there have been several Pope Juliuses, so I'm going to just kind of assume it was the second, because he was right before the Reformation. Okay, well, so let's suppose that Pope Julius did these things. Now, number one, actually, indulgences were never sold, so that's a myth. They were not sold. Indulgences were, at one time, given in exchange, well, I put it this way, indulgences are given as an incentive for performing certain spiritual acts. And at one time, one of the spiritual acts for which you could receive an indulgence was donating to a charitable cause, like the building of a church. And so did the distribution of indulgences support the building of St. Peter's Basilica? Sure they did. But what's wrong with that? I mean, charitable organizations today, all the time, offer premiums to people as a thank you and an incentive for their donations. And so the church did and does offer indulgences, which are a spiritual benefit, as a way of incentivizing people to do spiritual things, like say prayers and go to Mass and go on pilgrimages and things like that. And at one time, it also allowed them to make donations to charitable building funds, to church building funds. There's nothing wrong about that. And so certainly not in principle. And so this is something that's actually not a problem in principle, that's being presented as if it's something sinister and corrupt. And that of itself should be a warning sign to your sister that she is getting a biased account of things. Now, as far as backroom deals towards becoming Pope, I don't know if he did or not. I don't know what evidence we have regarding that, but since the process of electing a Pope is conducted secretly so that political pressures can't be brought to bear on it, it's somewhat hard to learn about the precise mechanics by which a particular individual became Pope. But let's suppose he did. Let's suppose he cut backroom deals. Let's suppose he bribed people. Let's suppose,
smoked cigars while doing it.
He even murdered people to become Pope. And I have no evidence of that at all. I've never even heard that claimed. But let's suppose he did something really bad to become Pope. You know what that proves? He was a sinner. Okay? That's exactly what it proves. Does it prove that he wasn't Pope? Not in the slightest. Does it prove that the papacy was not something Jesus instituted? Not in the slightest. All it proves is some popes are sinners, and some of them are, in fact, all popes are sinners, and some popes are big sinners. And you know who was a particularly big sinner as a pope?
John the 23rd, because of his girth.
Let me finish.
Oh.
St. Peter. Peter actually denied the Christian faith when in the courtyard of the Jewish high priest Caiaphas. When asked, "Are you that man's disciple?" i.e., are you a Christian? He said no. So he actually publicly denied the Christian faith in front of others. And yet, Jesus still accepted him as Pope, as illustrated by the fact that then after the resurrection, when St. Peter went fishing, Jesus has the encounter with Peter where he says, "Do you love me more than these?" indicating the other disciples who are present. And Peter says, "Lord, you know I love you." And Jesus says, "Feed my sheep," indicating that Peter is to be the spiritual pastor of the others, including the other disciples who were there. That's why he asked him, "Do you love me more than these?" And so Jesus, in spite of Peter's sin, forgave Peter and accepted him as the shepherd of his flock in his absence. And so even if Julius II was a horrendous sinner, so what? St. Peter was a horrendous sinner. It doesn't mean that Christ is incapable of forgiving him, and it doesn't mean that he didn't legitimately exercise authority on behalf of Christ. So if you point those out to your sister, that may help her out. She may have other issues that she's struggling with, but dealing with the ones that she's brought to your attention would be a good starting point.
Even if all the claims of the textbook were true.
Yeah.
Right.
So even if all those claims were true, so what? It doesn't do anything to affect the divine credentials of the Catholic Church and Jesus' founding of it and his appointment of the Pope. So, and you may want to, incidentally, you may want to get a copy of the podcast and play it for her so she can hear that discussion. And she's welcome to call in herself. We want to do anything we can to help her out.
I have to think Patrick Madrid's book, Pope Fiction, might
it
cover
also
that,
might help
that chapter of history. It makes sense, Selena?
Yes, thank you so much.
All right. Thank you for the call.